Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Tearing Down the Lost Cause, The Removal of New Orleans Confederate Statues by James Gill and Howard Hunter. Narrated by Logan Stearns. Chapter 1. Robert E. Lee. An abrupt downpour washed out the event, but it could not forestall Robert E. Lee's deification. On February 22, 1884, a crowd of 15,000 converged on Tivoli Circle in New Orleans to witness the unveiling of the Lee Monument. After Lee's death in 1870, the Lee Monumental Association raised $10,000 for a young New York sculptor, Alexander Doyle, to create a 16.5-foot statue in bronze, and raised an additional $26,000 for the local architect, John Roy, to erect a 60-foot marble column set on top of the pyramidal base of granite. It was a prodigious accomplishment, considering that the city had suffered financial ruin in the Panic of 1873. The 104-foot structure, along with the Shot Tower, 1883, and the New Orleans National Bank, 1882, defined the cityscape when engineers were just beginning to master the challenge of building vertically on a high water table. The Monumental Association included notables such as General P.G.T. Beauregard, CSA, Louisiana Supreme Court Justice, and Confederate veteran Charles Erasmus Fenner, and the cotton merchant Michael Musson, uncle of Edgar Degas. It was carnival season, and the Committee of Arrangements organized the event like the tableau of a Mardi Gras ball. Historians have marked the period between 1870 and 1914 as an era of invented tradition in which events were staged as if they were steeped in ancient ritual. The pageantry of the Lee Memorial was the first of its kind, coming 6 years before Richmond followed suit. The program was to honor Robert E. Lee with a poem written specifically for the unveiling, as well as a lengthy oration by Judge Fenner. 3,000 chairs were set on the west side of the monument for ladies who arrived an hour before the festivities were to commence. On the platform were 600 seats for big donors, nabobs, the Louisiana Supreme Court, members of Congress, the Monumental Association, and the Ladies Confederate Monumental Association, consuls, General of France, Great Britain, Germany, Mexico, the Netherlands, and the dual monarchy of the Austro-Hungarian Empire, and Confederate royalty, including Jefferson Davis and his two daughters. Lee's two daughters, Mary and Mildred, and Mrs. T.S. Kennedy, the daughter of Confederate Secretary of War, Stephen Mallory, all the Confederate veterans groups, the associations of the armies of Tennessee and Northern Virginia, and the Confederate States Cavalry were represented. And significantly, in a spirit of reconciliation, two posts of GAR, Union Veterans of the Grand Army of the Republic, along with a National Guard unit from Detroit, were there by invitation. At the foot of the monument, the flags of the foreign consulates fluttered in the wind as a band struck by Richard Wagner's Grand March Renzi. But just as the proceedings were about to begin at 2, the sky grew dark, and a torrential rain drove the crowd indoors. Yet, the veterans of the blue and gray were undeterred, and when two maimed veterans pulled a cord revealing the sculpture, a loud cheer went up. The ceremony resumed for the dignitaries in the armory of the Washington Artillery, the most prestigious and oldest of New Orleans military units. Charles Fenner, president of the association, presented the monument to Mayor William Behen, who, as a young officer in the Washington Artillery, had surrendered with Lee at Appomattox. Fenner, who was never lost for words, used the occasion to link Louisiana to the Lee myth. Louisiana is entitled to a full share in the glory of Lee, her sons illustrated by her valor every field on which his fame was won. President of the Association of the Army of Northern Virginia and future governor Francis T. Nichols assured Lee's daughters, "The blood of Louisiana was poured out on 100 hills and plains of Virginia, but they had done it willingly for Robert E. Lee and for duty." Alexander Doyle was 27 years old the year of the unveiling, and though he lacked the talent of an Augustus St. Gaudens, he was extraordinarily prolific. One newspaper claimed that, at 33, he had done more public monuments than any other sculptor, and was producer of more than a fifth of those standing in the country. Scion of a wealthy family in Steubenville, Ohio, Doyle was taken by his parents to Italy, where he was raised to be an aesthete, studying music, painting, and sculpture. After 2 years in the States to finish high school, he resumed his studies in sculpture in Italy, returning in 1878 to start a business in New York City. And it was a business. Doyle's family owned a limestone quarry in Indiana, and he parlayed his family's connections in limestone, granite, and marble into commissions for sculptures. He would go on to produce 5 major works in New Orleans. Doyle's Lee, on close inspection, leaves the viewer cold. As a work of art, it does not move or invoke. Stolid and phlegmatic, it is not the kindly Mars Robert of hagiographers. It clearly lacks the technical virtuosity of Doyle's other works, such as the bronze statue of Albert Sidney Johnston, located at the Army of Tennessee Tumulus and Metairie Cemetery. It also lacks the profundity of his elegant marble sculpture of Margaret Howery, or the majesty of his equestrian statue of Beauregard, which graced the entrance of City Park until 2017. Yet, high on his perch, General Lee had an aesthetic. The effect was more totemic and theatrical than artistic. Doyle's Lee was coolly poised to face another Yankee invasion with his arms folded. Facing north, the statue projected the defiance that was essential to the Lost Cause myth. And while New Orleans begged credulity as a Confederate city, the idea of the monument dedication by urban elites was to leave no doubt that New Orleans had come to rival Richmond as a bastion of Confederate civic ideology. According to the young scholar Joseph L. Henderson, as a general rule, it can be said that the need for hero symbols arises when the ego needs strengthening. New Orleans had undergone a double humiliation, military defeat, and federal occupation from 1862 to 1877. Along with the rest of the South, Confederate veterans and partisans turned to the Lost Cause as a palliative. The narrative turned into a catechism. Southern valor and heroism were to be celebrated. Secession was about a constitutional disagreement with the South defending its right as a sovereign state and slavery a non-issue. In his own life, Robert E. Lee preferred to obliterate the marks of civil strife regarding memorials, but became the patron saint of the Lost Cause. As a symbol, he assuaged Southern guilt and gave hope to the vanquished. He held a mirror up to the South and later to the whole country of a civilization lost only to be replaced by Gilded Age plutocrats and the avarice that defined the era. It was not a coincidence that the dedication took place on George Washington's birthday. By the 1880s, Southern apologists aggressively attempted to link the Confederacy to a national mythology through the Lee persona. Lee's connections to Washington were legitimate, since his father was the Revolutionary War hero, Light Horse Harry, Lee, who was a favorite of the Commander-in-Chief, and Lee the son, married Mary Custis, the step-great-granddaughter of Washington. That Lee took up arms against the United States was a mere technicality. In a great example of Gilded Age legerdemain, the Confederate cause became patriotic, and Lee, as Kirk Savage has argued, was the obvious man to personify a newly revised, newly remembered Confederacy. A Confederacy that pretended to have fought a heroic struggle not for slavery but for liberty, defined as the right of state to self-determination. In his oration at the dedication, Judge Fenner defended secession as positively American, a tradition that went back to the colonial separation from Great Britain. The problem was that by 1860, the North had embraced Daniel Webster's theory of national government, as opposed to the Southerners, who had remained loyal to the idea of a federal government and its concomitant state compact theory of government. Hence, the war was simply a misunderstanding, and Lee himself was one of the greatest of Americans. The dedication speech played in the New Orleans newspapers the next day. No Lost Cause tropes were spared for Lee's ascension to the Empyrean. Fenner started with Lee's lineage,
which was apropos at a time when Americans were obsessed with race and ethnicity.
The blood which coursed in his veins descended in purest strain through an illustrious ancestry running back to William the Conqueror, every record of which indicates a race of hereditary gentlemen. That the blood of Lancelot Lee, who landed with the Conqueror, and of Lionel, who fought with the Coeur de Lion, had not degenerated as it percolated through the centuries is evidenced by the history of the American Lee, whose founder was Richard Lee, courier of Charles I. Part of a Southern myth constructed in the 1850s was the notion that Southerners descended from the Normans, hence the feudal martial tradition that differentiated them from the Anglo-Saxons, who were more interested in pecuniary gain. This also played into the cavalier myth that the South, especially Virginia, was a refuge of royalists in the English Civil War, while the Roundheads flocked to New England, creating a dour society that hanged witches and heretics. Lee was the paladin of Sir Walter Scott novels, a fixation in the South, where jousting tournaments became a craze in the 1890s. While the idea of a Norman inheritance faded after the war, the conceit that the South was a superior civilization refused to die. Even H. L. Mencken, who regarded the South of his own era as a cultural wasteland, wrote in 1920 that before the Civil War, the South had been a civilization of manifold excellences, perhaps the best that the Western Hemisphere had ever seen, undoubtedly the best that these states had ever seen. America was still predominantly an evangelical country in the Gilded Age. Lee, by resisting the glittering temptation of the field command of the Federal Army in 1861, had replicated Christ's temptation in the desert. Like Jesus, Fenner professed, Lee was actually never really tempted. My study of his character forbids me to believe that such considerations ever assumed the dignity of a temptation to him. Purity of spirit defined Lee, and he constituted what American Protestants desperately wanted to see in themselves. Nevertheless, the social Darwinists also revered Lee.
When it came to ranking the human species, he was on the top pseudoscience rung, the apotheosis of the Anglo-Saxon Christian gentleman.
As Thomas Connolly has argued, Lee was becoming a national hero at a time when the country was threatened by unsettling forces, namely Eastern and Southern European immigration, along with a rapacious industrialization. Charles Francis Adams, a Union Army veteran, brother of the historian Henry Adams, and an ardent social Darwinist, gave a paper to the American Antiquarian Society in 1901, honoring Lee, titled The Confederacy and the Transvaal, A People's Obligation to Robert E. Lee. Looking to the Boer War as a cautionary tale after the fact, Adams argued that Lee had saved the country by sending his men home rather than into the mountains to carry on a protracted guerrilla war. By doing so, Lee promoted reconciliation. Reconciliation and the Lost Cause became two sides of the same coin in the 1880s. The celebration of Southern manhood and valor was a way to rebuild the country. The caveat was that the South could reconcile on its own terms. Two independent narratives developed in the North and South, and any rights Southern blacks achieved during Reconstruction withered away. In New Orleans, where Confederate and Union Army veterans lived in the same locale, and where there had been a critical mass of Unionists during the war, reconciliation was a necessity if the city was going to regain its pre-war status as a preeminent economic power.
And according to Lewis Harlan, Republican merchants of the city tended toward a Whiggish republicanism, more interested in sugar protection and internal subsidies for river and harbor improvements and railroads than a radical vision.
Reconciliation was good for business, and gradually the Confederate faction offered up its own terms that became the standard civic ideology. Reconciliation in New Orleans officially started with U.S. soldiers and sailors marching on Mardi Gras in the Rex Parade of 1876. The New Orleans Times wrote,
It clearly indicates what has been reiterated, that nowhere could be found people more truly devoted to the nation, nor more anxious to obliterate all acrimony, than we of the South. As David Potter argued,
regional identity and national identity are, in fact, complementary
rather than antithetical.
And as long as the South could reconcile on its own terms, patriotism to the nation,
as Roland Osterwies averred,
became largely peculiar to the South.
6 months before the Lee dedication, the Joseph A. Maurer Post of the GAR
received a letter from a joint committee of the Association of the Armies of Northern Virginia and Tennessee.
The reciprocal feelings of respect and amity that have grown up between your organization and those we represent lead the committee to hope that you will find it possible to give them active cooperation in the mimicry of war they desire to represent.
The mimicry of war was to be a Civil War-style reenactment to raise money for a Confederate soldier's home in the Crescent City. The Veterans Association promoted the affairs as a grant lottery scheme. For a dollar ticket, one could view the entertainment to be held at the fairgrounds and participate in the drawing for 100 prizes ranging from a handsome cottage on Constance Street, worth $1,500 to a cup and saucer. Significantly, the event was billed not as a North-South contest, but simply as a two-day battle between the home team and the invaders, with Union and Confederate veterans on both sides. 10,000 spectators attended, and by all accounts, the event was a grand success. Charges and retreats, flanking maneuvers, firefights, and artillery barrages provided the onlookers with an authentic Civil War experience. The newspapers covered the reenactment like a sporting event and even participated in the sham with laconic reportage such as,
Major Willett of the Veterans Battalion had his lower jaw torn off by a shell, but this is not confirmed. After the valiant adversaries fought to a draw, participants and spectators repaired to the Great Hall of the fairgrounds and danced into the morning hours.
By the day of the dedication of the Lee Monument, reconciliation had become the norm. After laudatory remarks about Lee's heritage, the perfection of both Lee's appearance and his soul, the legality of secession, Lee's genius as a field commander and lost cause, Fenner was careful to end his address by praising the Union veterans.
Let nothing I have said be constituted as disparaging the valor of the Union troops, the skill of their leaders, or the splendor of their achievements.
But, for some citizens, reconciliation came at a price.
Less than a mile away from the dedication, a special committee of the U.S. Senate, under Republican George Hoar, of Massachusetts, conducted hearings regarding elections in Capaya County, Mississippi.
The situation was so explosive that the committee conducted the investigation in New Orleans rather than Hazlehurst, the county seat. The violence stemmed from a movement by a former sheriff, John Prentice, Print Matthews, to organize an independent party that included both poor black and white farmers. Matthews came from a predominant slaveholding family, but had sided with the Union throughout the war. During Reconstruction, he became a powerful Republican, serving 3 terms as sheriff.
Capaya County had a slim black majority,
with approximately 14,000 blacks to 13,000 whites. When Matthews organized his independent party in 1883 and lured some white Democrats into the ranks, the local Democratic Party formed a paramilitary organization of night riders, with 150 armed men who terrorized the black population by murder and torture. The leader of the group,
Erastus
Wheeler, was actually a friend of Matthews, which makes it all the more bizarre that it was Wheeler who fired a double-barreled shotgun into Matthews' chest
on election day, mortally wounding him.
Matthews had 2 sons away at college and 2 daughters and a wife at home. The Democrats carried the county by 2,000 votes. Wheeler was acquitted by an all-white jury under the claim of self-defense.
Senator Hoar's majority report was a scathing indictment of the political situation in Capaya County.
The minority report of the Democratic senators was a disgrace. The paramilitary group was just some lawless individuals who had no connection to the Democratic Party. Black witnesses were unreliable, and Matthews probably had it coming to him for stirring up trouble. The two Democratic senators on the committee, Eli Salisbury of Delaware and Benjamin F. Jonas of Louisiana, were seated on the platform at the monument dedication that would transform military defeat into moral victory and establish Lee for all eternity as an American hero. The crowd was too enraptured to contemplate the lessons of Ozymandias and could never have imagined the scene that would unfold on the very spot 134 years later, where former rebels had attended what amounted to Lee's canonization. A later generation would gather in distinctly unreverential mood when the day for the statue's removal arrived. It was the ultimate indignity for an icon that had dominated the skyline for generations. But a feeling almost of anticlimax reigned around Lee Circle, a sense that the occasion was historical and portentous, was much more in evidence in an antebellum Greek revival building a few blocks away,
where Mayor Mitch Landrieu
rose to his feet just as masked workers clambered onto a crane and prepared to winch the statue from its perch. On May 19, 2017,
Landrieu
was there to explain his rationale for removing the Confederate memorials from the streets of New Orleans. He had planned for a rapturous reception. Attendance was by invitation only, and the audience had been carefully vetted, and the speech was widely praised when a transcript was released and a YouTube video went viral. The removal of the statue had prompted oratory as impassioned as its unveiling would have if the heavens had not opened in 1884. But the message could not have been more different.
Between Behan and Landrieu, the city had come full circle, where one mayor attended Lee's apotheosis, another gloried in bringing him down to earth.
No voice was publicly raised in dissent when Lee went up, but plenty of arguments went on around the base of his column
during the hours-long process of taking him away.
Lee's statue was the last of four Confederate monuments targeted for removal. The other three were statues of Confederate President Jefferson Davis and Beauregard and the Liberty Monument, a granite obelisk commemorating
a Reconstruction-era putsch on the streets of New Orleans.
Death threats had scared off all but one removal contractor, whose employees, wearing masks and flak jackets, appeared unannounced to do each of the first three jobs in the dead of night. That approach was not feasible for the Lee statue because of its elevation and the proximity of power and streetcar lines, so the coup de grace came under leaden skies late on a muggy Friday afternoon. The roads around Lee Circle had been closed to traffic since 4 o'clock that morning, and onlookers came and went all day, with Confederate battle flag wavers heavily outnumbered in a crowd that never exceeded several hundred. Police cars surrounded the Lee column while the rival factions exchanged acerbities. Two men squared up for a fight, but thought better of it. Overall, the threat of violence that hung in the air at earlier confrontations was not in evidence.
As the crowd dwindled, Malcolm Suber, head of Take Him Down, NOLA,
which had campaigned for the statue's removal, picked up a loudspeaker and urged everyone to remain and witness history. When the statue finally came down, the crowd sang, "Hey, hey, goodbye."
And Suber announced a New Orleans street party would be held to celebrate.
He suggested that a suitable replacement atop the column would be a statue of Dorothy May Taylor, a late New Orleans city councilwoman who had passed an ordinance that mandated the desegregation of Mardi Gras parades in 1992. The Monumental Task Committee, a coalition that had tried to keep the monuments in place, declared the city's conduct more fitting to ISIS tactics than the United States of America.
Suber, an adjunct political science professor at New Orleans'
predominantly black Southern University, was an avowed communist who had neglected no opportunity to assail the white elite in 40 years.
He and another firebrand activist named Carl Gallman had campaigned successfully to remove the names of Confederate heroes from the city's public schools a quarter century earlier.
At the time, Gallman had also called for the Liberty Monument to be thrown in the river.
Now, Suber's group was demanding the removal not only of Confederate relics but also of any monument to an alleged racial oppressor, including a president of the United States. "We can't get no satisfaction until you take down Andrew Jackson," Suber's sidekick, Michael Quest Moore, told the crowd. Moore, a dreadlock teacher at a local charter school who fancied himself a poet, had fallen under Suber's spell when he moved to New Orleans from Brooklyn several years earlier. Landrieu's objective had been achieved, but Take Him Down had no intention of letting up. Suber and Moore had been agitating in this cause with extra intensity since 2014, when white police officer Darren Wilson shot unarmed black teenager Michael Brown to death in Ferguson, Missouri, a year before Landrieu called on the New Orleans City Council to remove the four Confederate monuments. Suber was eager to take credit. "We will not let Mitch Landrieu claim this," he declared as the Lee statue was lowered to the ground. Landrieu already had, and the applause was loud and long when he wound up his speech that day. The venue was a three-story marble edifice built in 1853, fronted by Ionic columns and designed by James Gallier, which had served for a century as City Hall. The contrast between Landrieu's drab modern offices and the ornate splendor of Mayor Behn's was as stark as the two men's divergent views on the Lee statue. The reviews of Landrieu's speech in magazines and newspapers were uniformly fulsome. This was public oratory at its most scintillating, a clarion call for historical truth and morality, according to commentary in publications ranging from the New York Times to Esquire magazine. There was no denying the power of Landrieu's speech in its firm denunciation of lost cause myths and the legacy of slavery and Jim Crow. It was practically impossible to come away without agreeing that the Confederacy was on the wrong side of history and humanity. New Orleans, Landrieu reminded the audience, was America's largest slave market, a port where hundreds of thousands of souls were bought, sold, and shipped up the Mississippi River to live of forced labor, of rape, of torture. America was the place where nearly 4,000 of our fellow citizens were lynched, 540 alone in Louisiana, where the courts enshrined separate but equal, where freedom riders coming to New Orleans were beaten to a bloody pulp. So when people say to me that the monuments in question are history, well, what I just described is real history too, and it is the searing truth. The monuments now removed from the streets, Landrieu proclaimed, purposefully celebrate a fictional, sanitized Confederacy, ignoring the death, ignoring the enslavement, and the terror that it actually stood for. Landrieu was so convinced of this searing truth that he nowhere questioned whether it was the whole truth or sought to explain why the monument's controversy had invoked a profound sense of nostalgia that was by no means restricted to the diehards in the Sons of the Confederacy. The organization was not, in any case, the simple collection of nostalgic bigots its title might suggest. Head of its local chapter was Eads Hogue, an attorney at a silk stocking firm, who, as a federal prosecutor more than 30 years earlier, had secured the conviction of mob boss Carlos Mesello. Hogue thought that what he saw as the obliteration of history to suit the mores of later generations was a Philistine act. But if Landrieu had any doubts about the justice of his cause, he hid them well. Perhaps his oratory was all the more impassioned and powerful for lacking nuance. Landrieu, 56 years old at the time, had by his own admission only later come to the conclusion that Confederate relics were an affront to modern sensibilities. He had moreover needed help to see what was now a searing truth, because he had passed the monuments all his life without giving them a second thought and wondering how black people would react. That all changed in 2014 when New Orleans' native son, Wynton Marsalis, the trumpeter and composer, was in town to give a concert. Marsalis agreed to join the executive committee of the commission Landrieu had established to plan the tricentennial of the city's founding in 2018, but had a suggestion. Rename Lee Circle. Landrieu recalled that when he asked why, Marsalis replied, "Let me help you see it through my eyes. Who is he? What does he represent?" And in the most prominent space in the city of New Orleans, does that space reflect who we were, who we want to be, or who we are? Landrieu's family had long dominated the liberal wing of New Orleans politics.
His father, Moon, had integrated City Hall as mayor 40 years earlier, and his sister, Mary, had served 3 terms as Democratic U.S. Senator, although she was about to be defeated in her re-election bid.
If a Landrieu could have failed to appreciate that the adulation of Confederates might cause resentment, the monuments were clearly not an issue in white society. Marcellus's sentiments were hardly universal among black people either, and no public clamor prompted Landrieu's proposal that the monuments come down. A poll conducted shortly after Landrieu
made his pitch found that 46% of black respondents in Louisiana were for removal, with 31% opposed, while a large majority of whites favored retention.
Landrieu was foisting his newly discovered principles on a largely indifferent public. The monuments had been a familiar part of the cityscape, time out of mind. Few had paused to ponder their significance until Landrieu forced the issue. By the time he rose to his feet, in what is now known as Gallier Hall, Landrieu was brimming with moral certitude and indignation.
First, he made the time-worn argument that the distinctive character of New Orleans is a product of racial diversity. The soul of our beloved city is deeply rooted in a history that has evolved over thousands of years. He intoned, rooted in a diverse people who have been here together every step of the way, for both good and ill. It is a history that holds in its heart the stories of Native Americans, the Choctaw, Homa Nation, the Chitimacha,
of Hernando de Soto, Robert Cavalier, Sieur de La Salle, the Acadians, the Isleños, the enslaved people from Senegambia, free people of color, the Haitians, the Germans, both the empires of France and Spain, the Italians, the Irish, the Cubans, the South and Central Americans, the Vietnamese, and so many more.
You see, New Orleans is truly a city of many nations, a melting pot, a bubbling cauldron of many cultures. There is no other place quite like it in the world that so eloquently exemplifies the uniquely American motto, E pluribus unum, out of many, we are one.
As to why that was not the case in 1861, Landrieu offered no fresh insights.
He was obviously right to declare that the Robert E. Lee, Jefferson Davis, and P.G.T. Beauregard statues were not erected just to honor these men, but as part of the movement which became known as the Cult of the Lost Cause, and were meant to rebrand the history of our city and the ideals of a defeated Confederacy.
But the notion of a superior civilization that flourished in the antebellum South was too entrenched in many white minds to be shaken by pious platitudes. It was Landrieu, according to the Sons of Confederate Veterans, who was out to rebrand the city. Meanwhile, the Suber faction was never going to settle for the removal of only 4 monuments. When several more remained and Confederates were memorialized in street names throughout the city, Marcellus was not the only citizen, or indeed the only distinguished jazz trumpeter and composer, to have been offended all his life by the monuments. Landrieu declared in his Gallier Hall speech.
In the audience was Terence Blanchard, who went to a high school on the edge of City Park named after one of America's greatest heroes and patriots, John F. Kennedy. But to get to school, Blanchard had to pass a monument to a man who fought to deny him his humanity. Beauregard, this is something I never thought I'd see in my lifetime.
It's a sign that the world is changing, Blanchard said, according to Landrieu. Yes, Terence, it is, and it's long overdue, Landrieu said, not undervaluing his own contribution.
We have not erased history. We are becoming part of the city's history by righting the wrong image those monuments represent and crafting a better, more complete future for our children and for future generations. And unlike when these Confederate monuments were first erected as a symbol of white supremacy, we now have a chance to create not only new symbols, but to do it together as one people.
Those noble sentiments were conveyed with sufficient panache for Landrieu to emerge as the Demosthenes of Dixie Democrats. The rafters rang when he repudiated a 4-year brief historical aberration that was called the Confederacy, and urged a celebration of our rich, diverse history. Instead.
But plenty of people outside the hall did not think the choice was so simple.
A society that retained racial segregation for a century after the Civil War does not have an unqualified claim to a rich, diverse history.
And it was the war that lasted 4 years, not the lost cause. The idea incubated for decades, and Europe was already fighting World War I when Beauregard was unveiled in New Orleans.
Confederate apologists have proved so effective that defenders of the displaced monuments were still accepting the preposterous notion that the war was not fought over slavery.
The arguments that the South fought for a constitutional principle and the 10th Amendment had been passed down the generations.
Landrieu, in his speech, destroyed that claim by quoting Confederate Vice President Alexander H. Stephens' declaration that the Confederacy's cornerstone rests upon the great truth that the Negro is not equal to the white man, that slavery, subordination to the superior race, is his natural and normal condition, that the cult of the lost cause endured is testimony not only to the tenacity of its propagandists, but also to the cost in blood and money that the Civil War exacted.
The collective memory was too painful to doubt that the South stood for honor and high principle.
It was unthinkable that the flower of its manhood had been sacrificed for a tawdry purpose. And no sooner was the Civil War over than the South began its search for vindication.
It was political alchemy. Secession became not treason but patriotism. The Southern soldier fought in brave and chivalrous defense of home and hearth against a brutish invader.
Antebellum Louisiana thrived while contented slaves attended a refined and elegant ruling caste, and young blades vied for the attention of Creole beauties. An ideal society had vanished from the face of the earth, and its memory had to be cherished. The more time that elapsed after the Civil War, the more firmly that idealized picture was embraced in white minds, even as the civil rights era dawned, that the concept of a cultural beacon was all hogwash and wishful thinking, according to Landrieu, have now become self-evident. But the cult of the lost cause retains enough of a powerful grip to raise the question of whether it contains an element of truth. If the antebellum South prospered on the backs of slaves, so too, for instance, did the ancient Greece, to which architectural gems such as Gallier Hall were a homage.
Lost cause cultists fancy that the similarity did not end there, back when New Orleans, with a port vital to global trade, was called the Queen of the South. Chapter 2. New Orleans before the Civil War. A.J. Liebling's apperçu of New Orleans in 1960 as a Mediterranean city,
like Genoa, or Marseille, or Beirut, or the Egyptian Alexandria, made him a literary hero among locals who never felt particularly Southern.
The Latin flavor of the town, with its live-and-let-live sensuality, racial and ethnic diversity, Catholic ritual and spectacle, and appalling poverty, is far removed from Jackson, Atlanta, or even Charleston. Baton Rouge, only 80 miles upriver, seems a foreign land.
Nevertheless, while vestigial French and African culture traditions remain and evolve, the notion of New Orleans as sui generis can be taken too far, easily reverting to cliché and caricature and encomiums like
the most northern city of the Caribbean
are part and parcel of a citizenry given to self-mythologizing.
The fact is that no matter what may set New Orleans apart, it is above all an American city, and the overriding theme of the 19th century was the influx of Anglo-Protestants who came to exert control of both politics and the local economy. Even Mardi Gras, a European Catholic holiday, was not spared the dominion of Anglo-Protestant elites.
In 1860, New Orleans had an official population of 168,000, although the outlying suburbs, such as the cities of Carleton, Algiers, and Jefferson, would raise the number to about 180,000 souls.
What was not unusual for American cities, the majority of the population did not come from New Orleans. Almost 40% were foreign-born, with the largest number of immigrants from Ireland, followed by Germany and France, and a significant number of citizens hailed from northern states. As Ted Tunnell surmised, among the residents there were more natives of New York and Pennsylvania than natives of any southern state, except for Louisiana itself. While New Orleans had the largest number of free blacks in the South, at almost 11,000 residents, this mostly Afro-Creole population.
Free people of color, also known as gens de couleur libre,
French-speaking and Catholic, had declined in the 1850s from almost 20,000 persons owing to a planter-dominated state legislature that grew increasingly hostile to free people of color. In 1830, this group made up over a quarter of the population, dominated the skilled artisan trades, and included educated professionals, even some slaveholders, but denied political equality and having to endure a hostile legislature that attempted to bar the entry of free blacks into the state and even made manumission illegal. Many black Creoles fled to Paris, Mexico City, or northern locales. With large-scale Irish and German immigration, the Anglo invasion,
and the general diaspora of free blacks,
the percentage of free people of color stood at 6% on the eve of the Civil War, while the slave population of 8% was by far the smallest of any major southern city. This did not include the slaves kept in pens at the numerous markets catering to the notorious internal slave trade. Human chattel waiting to be poked and prodded by potential buyers, open for all to see.
The Gallic community of white Creoles and black Creoles
became a minority by the 1840s as a result of the Protestants flooding the city. The first group arrived after the Louisiana Purchase in 1803. The second influx came with the economic boom of the 1830s, and the third migration came with the economic recovery of the 1840s after the crash of 1837. The Anglo-American invasion was so substantial that even with large-scale immigration from Ireland, Gascony, and southern German states in 1840s and 1850s, the city was only 46% Catholic by 1860. It was the theft of Mardi Gras that sealed the triumph of Saxon over Gaul, as the rival ethnic groups were whimsically styled. The plot was hatched by a group of outsiders who had joined the influx seeking opportunity in the city's burgeoning economy. They spent their evenings conversing and smoking cigars at a pharmacy owned by John Pope, a native of Brooklyn with a literary bent alien to the city. A favorite topic at Pope's place was the sorry condition of what had been the signature event in the Creole cultural calendar. Mardi Gras had a patchy history since it was first celebrated in Louisiana by Jean-Baptiste Limon, Sieur de Benville, on his arrival in 1699. 19 years before he founded New Orleans.
The celebration fell in and out of favor with colonial authorities and was initially banned after the Louisiana Purchase, only to be revived in accordance with the Parisian model.
By the 1830s, well-organized parades were hailed by the press as a spectacular addition to a venerable Creole preserve. But it was not to last. Ruffians amused themselves by throwing flour on respectable citizens venturing into public, and then graduated to quicklime and bricks. Fewer maskers appeared in public each year, and such parades as occurred were small and impromptu.
Diehards attended private bal-masques, but English and French language newspapers bemoaned the decline of a fine tradition and called for an end to the decadent tumult that had replaced it.
But the bilingual consensus that Mardi Gras should not be allowed to die out served as a call to action in John Pope's circle. In fact, Mardi Gras' best days lay ahead. On January 4th, 1857, prosperous Anglo newcomers of around the same age as Pope, who was then 30, received an invitation to meet a few of your friends, 6 days later, in the club room over the Gem Saloon.
It was signed by Pope and five members of his drugstore, Coterie.
S.M. Todd, from Utica, New York. F. Shaw, whose origins have been ascribed to New York and Alabama. L.D. Addison, from Kentucky.
Joseph Ellison, from Louisville, Kentucky.
And William Ellison, from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Although, none of the invitation's 13th recipients was a Creole either. Pope evidently could not find a suitable locale in the city's American sector to plan his carnival coup. The Gem Saloon was on Royal Street in the French Quarter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.